Thanks everybody for coming on out. I know Mother Nature's kind of played us a little mean trick, and next week we might have some snow. So anyway, hopefully some people have gotten out to play a little bit this winter and dusted those clubs off a little, but you're going to learn a lot today. We've got an amazing panel today who all their credentials probably go without saying, but first and foremost, thank Matt Dobyns, Fresh Meadow, for hosting here. For all that great spread and the, you know, Chobani yogurt and grab a couple.
It's not members only, by the way. Whatever you do.
So thanks for all arranging all that. Again, this panel's credentials, I think, go without saying, but just kind of a couple major highlights. We've got people have played, this panel consists of 13 major championship appearances. And Jessica will make it number 14 this summer when she competes in the 2017 Women's PGA Championship at Olympia Fields. So congratulations to you. And the experience and the talent here, we are all going to learn something. And I think the biggest premise on why we created this is not only to help you learn, and maybe you learn how to make the PGA Championship or a US Open, but to play at any level, right? We all play with members. We all get out there and do our thing and in pro-ams and whatnot. We just want to play a little better. And I guarantee you, whatever level you're at, you're going to pick up a nugget today that's going to help your game. So anyway, we're just going to kind of go around. I'm going to tee up some ideas, and our esteemed panel here will hit them out of the park. So let's start with Mr. Rob Labritz. Now, Rob, you're You've had some pretty good success in the game. Let's talk about how you prepare your physical nature, your training in the gym, or this cryotherapy we've all seen on social media.
Works.
So just tell us some of the things and some of the mindsets that you go through in preparation, off-season, in-season sort of training.
Okay. First of all, welcome everybody. Thanks for making the trip out today to Fresh Meadow. I know coming from Westchester, going over the bridge is a pain in the butt, but we all made it and we're here. So thank you for coming out, and thanks to the panel for Dobyns for hosting us. But that being said, it was one of those things where starting out as an assistant, you're trying to figure it all out. So sitting out here, trying to listen to the better players, the Daryl Kestners, the Bruce Zabriskies of the day, trying to listen to what they did to really prepare themselves to play good golf. For me, it was all time management and figuring out that. I was really bad at time management when I first started out as an assistant golf pro. I didn't know, what to do with my time. I thought you just taught, went home, and worked on your game, whatever it was. But, over the years, as you become, first assistant and then a head golf pro and then a director of golf, the time management becomes so, it's the only thing in my life that kind of puts my, I put my priorities through time. I basically set my schedule up a year in advance with tournaments and outings and appearances or whatever I have to do for my club, meetings. And then throughout the year, I'm trying to constantly just sort of mix around the schedule. I try to leave certain spaces open for things that pop up and certain things that I have to get done. But for the most part, it's a long day. I've sacrificed a lot. My family feels it. I feel it just to play well and succeed in my job. And I know that's the way the golf industry is. But sacrifice is how you kind of get higher and higher. Besides that, for me, it's really just putting time. I wake up early. I start the day early. I start the day with working out. I love to do yoga and get in the gym early with my trainer.
What time do you wake up?
I'm usually up around 4:30, 5 o'clock.
That's it.
Not a big, but I go to bed early. I go to bed at 8, 9 o'clock.
There we go.
At 10 o'clock. So it's not like, when I get up, it's just one of those things. I've got children, so I got to spend time with them. So for me, it's really, my whole life consists of golf, teaching, playing, coaching my students, the club, and fitness, and then my family. So I really have 6 things that I focus on in my life, and I don't have any time for anything else, really. That's the way it is, and that's where my life has kind of taken me. But that being said, I love every minute of it. I've created this this life for myself over the past 16 years to do that. So to answer your question, how do you know who you are, you know what you can do, and then you try to hone your skills based on what you think and what you know you see results in. So that being said, I know I like to play a lot. I love to compete. It's probably the one thing that keeps me going throughout my entire life is competing at the game of golf. It's not teaching. It's not running a club. It's just competing. I love to compete. So my whole life is kind of centered around making sure that I perform my best when I'm playing in our section of tournaments and when I get to major championships. I have a team at the club, which has been developed over the past 16 years at Glen Arbor, which is, I couldn't do without them, period. I've got a great team. They're unbelievable. In every director of golf's absence when I'm gone, I don't ever worry about anything. I never worry about, is this being taken care of, is that being taken care of, because the team that's in place at Glen Arbor is so good that I can leave with a free conscience. So that being said, it all comes down to just kind of scheduling yourself, okay, having your idea of what you want to get accomplished for the year, and then you'll have monthly deals and weekly deals and then daily deals, but making sure that you have everything put aside to have all those things taken care of. For me to leave for, we'll use the professional national championship for example, for me to leave for 7 days in the last 14 years, I've missed every member guest. Our main member guest, I've missed every one of them.
And you still have your job. I still have my job.
It's crazy. Every time it moves, the member guest, it's one of these things where the only time that it's my schedule's ever been adjusted for the club was when I got married. We had the club championships the weekend I got married, they got pushed back a week. So that goes to show you how much they really like, having sort of me there and stuff. But that being said, to be able to miss your member guests and still know that it's going to run to a top notch, it doesn't say anything about me. It says everything about the team. So it gives me time to prepare and get ready for all these tournaments. So it just takes a while to sculpt yourself into that being.
I kind of want to go down the line of how we prepare physically. I mean, think of all the areas of the game that we need to be proficient at. To be fit is very helpful. To be golf fit is even more helpful. To understand how to, prepare for tournaments and things like that. There's lots of parts of the game that I want to cover, but who else wants to maybe take a stab on maybe how you prepare in the gym and, when do you do it or who have you kind of worked with or anybody?
I'll take that. I always love listening to Rob because I think it brings up an interesting dichotomy. If I attempted to run my life like Rob runs his, I don't think I would be successful. And the reason is because I've tried to force myself into that peg of being extraordinarily structured, extraordinarily goal oriented. And when I tried to do that stuff, let's say 10, 15 years ago. What ended up happening was I stopped being myself. And I think you have to really understand who you are as a person. And what I mean by that is what can you realistically expect yourself to do? I'm not getting up at 4:30 in the morning. It's not going to happen, right? So
I wish it didn't happen.
I also don't look like Rob. But there was a time, and I've worked for 5 years with Ben Shear, and he helped me do a lot. And what I learned in that 5 years was, and this is when I was doing nothing in the wintertime, what he always would say to me is, hey, I know I have to drag you in here, which is what he did. He had to drag me in there. I didn't like being there. And he said, he gave me a routine that I could do in 15 minutes. And in that 15 minutes, it was enough corrective exercises to at least help me tread water to stay where I was. And so that's what I do. So at night, I do 15 minutes, strictly corrective, and I putt for 15 minutes. Because I know that that's really all I can expect of myself to do with regularity. But I know I can do it. And then as far as the goals go, I used to have a lot of goals about I want to win this or I want to play in that. And I got so focused on the end point that I my journey kind of became irrelevant. And I sort of equate it to, you know, every time I play the lottery, my goal is to win the lottery, you know. But that doesn't really mean anything, you know. So really, the most meaningful part of the goal setting in my mind is when I set a goal, I set a goal of I want to give 30 minutes of attention to my driver today. And that's my goal. And then all the performance stuff happens or it doesn't. And that's when I started playing really well, which was, you know, 6 or 7 years ago, was when I started to accept those things. And when I started to really be myself and not beat myself up for not standing on the range and practicing till dark. So I think, you know, kind of being truthful to who you are and structuring your routine based around that, I think would help pretty much anybody.
A couple of these corrective exercises you're talking, what is there anything you could share with the group of something, not giving away all your secrets?
So you know, the fitness, you know, we could have a whole conversation about the relevance of fitness and what should be done and what shouldn't. For me, you know, breaking up fascia in my hips is probably important. I think.
How do you do that?
So I have a high intensity vibrating foam roller.
Okay.
So a routine that used to take me like 40 minutes on a normal foam roller, I can get done in 15 now.
Wow.
Because it's such a high frequency, it gets in there and really hurts like hell. Mm-hmm. But it's good. It's over 15 minutes. So those things I do. I do some band work. You know, some, you know, alternate side band work. But listen, I'm not barely breaking a sweat when I do it.
Right.
Because if I
right.
do, if it becomes hard for me, I know I won't do it. So, you know, it's all good. So don't beat yourself up too much. The pro when I was growing up is funny because this guy, I'd like to slap him around, but the course where I played, right? He's a nice enough guy. And the pro came over, and I don't think he could break 100, but he came over and he said, you know, you could really be good if you practiced. And I remember thinking to myself, well, God, I play every single day, you know? And I was like, and I thought, maybe he's right. So then I started, you know, hitting balls all day long. And what a mistake that was, you know? If I could go back and talk to myself when I was 14, I would say, get off the range and go play more. And you have to, you know, be able to sort of navigate those things. The one thing that Rob is great at is managing time, and that's a big thing. But the one thing I will say is that as busy as we all are, I found that I do a lot better performance-wise in 15-minute burst practices two or three times a day than I do standing there for an hour. I get lost in 45 minutes in whatever I'm doing. So I will putt for 15 minutes, and then I might not do anything until 4 p.m., and I might hit 15 minutes of drivers. And it helps because you got to be ready to stand to jump on the first tee and go play anyway. So it's not like you need to get, you know, super loose and warmed up before you can even move. You know, so yeah, that's my
idea. And Sara, let's get the ladies involved here a little bit. So we talked a little about time management. You know, being true to yourself. Talk a little bit about some of the, you know, the season long practice planning that you do for yourself and you have. I mean, even for your students, you know, obviously this is, you know, this idea is all to help us, but can, you know, we can obviously help a lot of our students along the way as well, so.
Sure thing. So, I need to preface that. I work at Quaker Ridge, and we don't really have a range. So we turn a couple holes into a range at certain parts of the day for the members, but I can't go hit balls for an hour. So I've learned to be a little bit creative, and generally, I found that, and this could be applicable to anything that anyone's doing, but like this time of year, I like to look at the tournament calendar and just put it all on a piece of paper in front of me, get all the months laid out, and I think we'd all agree that you can't really expect to peak during every single tournament, right? Especially as assistants, we have an opportunity to play every Monday, and then we have the section events, then we have the women's events, so there's a lot that can happen. So I like to look at the calendar and say, okay, I'm going to pick out 5 events that I would like to do well in. And those 5 events, hopefully, they mesh well with the club calendar. For instance, I know this year, Women's U.S. Open qualifying is the day after our 3-day men's member guest. So that's on my radar. But instead of freaking out about that and saying, okay, I probably won't hit a ball, you know, 3 days before that qualifier, what I personally found is kind of nice and a little more stress-free is if you can highlight those five events or so that you want to do well in. I like to manage my time so that about 2 weeks in advance, that's when I'm getting up early, so I'll do a little bit of what Rob does. To hit balls at Quaker, you have to get there around 5:30, 6 in the morning, and then by 8, the range doesn't really exist anymore, so at least for pros. So anyway, so 2 weeks in advance, I'll kind of get up early and do that, and then I'll stay late at work, I'll play in the evenings. But then a week in advance, when we talk about time management, I think we also have to talk about energy management. And I would much rather tee off in an event with energy rather than having hit 500 balls the week before every single day. So 2 weeks in advance, I'll give it a pretty good push and hit balls, play as much as I can. And then the week leading up to it, it's more like Matt. I'll putt for 15 minutes after work, but I might go home when the sun is still shining. And then I might actually get 8 hours of sleep that week, just leading up so that when you're actually playing, you don't have blisters on your hands. You haven't had to have those late night, early morning range sessions the day or two in advance. So I think the long-term planning really helps, and I think it also helps you make decisions when those last-minute things pop up. When your friends say, hey, it's so-and-so's birthday, and we're getting together on Thursday, mm-hmm. You're thinking, okay, Thursday was the day that I was going to play golf. I actually take a more proactive approach and say, hey, it's this person's birthday on Thursday. In my mind, I'm like, that's one of my practice nights. Let's all get together on Wednesday or something like that. So having that long-term sort of outlook can help you make decisions and helps you prioritize the things that you say yes and no to as well, that are take up the limited time that we have outside of golf.
Great. And Pat, now you've got, a lot of people here have families,
yes.
Right? You're not excluded from yes. that category, but how do you manage your time with, now Pat, he was a Gil McNally Award winner for the most improved golfer in the Met section a few years back, and so he knows how to, turn the game around and make it go very, very well. Talk to us a little about how you manage your time.
First, I eliminate the gym altogether, so I don't follow Rob. I actually started working out this year slowly, so making a step in the right direction. I kind of do a combination of what Matt and Sarah do. Like Sarah, I'll look at my club calendar first and then go towards the playing schedule. It's kind of a little different this past year. I mean, I was 8 years at Garden City and often call that fantasy land working because it was as good as it gets, and Bob did a very good job starting there and making sure certain events didn't fall when Met Open would fall or Met PGA Championship. So being at the Crescent Club, which is a lot busier, I look at that schedule, and even last year there was a couple events that I just took right off my calendar. Like I knew I wasn't gonna do US Open qualifying because it just wasn't gonna work out. So rather than go and attempt to play and not be prepared for it, I just said, let me erase that one and I'll build up to another. I'll work with my wife and kind of let her figure out the home schedule and when I need to be home and when I can be at work and have a little extra time playing or practicing. I think Mike Diffley a few years ago said something very similar to Matt, where I don't care if you hit balls every day or practice every day, at least give yourself 15 minutes and schedule it. So I'll do a lot of short practices. Bob can attest, if I was really ever on the range, it's because I was really searching for something. I'll chip and putt. And if I have an hour, I'm going out to play. I'll find a junior that I've been working with or a member and kind of do two things at once and talk myself through playing out there with them and try to help them at the same time.
Yeah, that's a great strategy. I know that most of us don't have hour blocks to just go and work on our game. It's certainly difficult to do that, but we always have 15, 20 minutes, here maybe 3-4 times in the day.
Yeah, and when I talk about playing golf now, I'll get an 18-hole round in at the club, but it's more, I'll play for an hour, or I'll play for an hour and a half. It's not, I'm gonna go out and play 9 holes, so whatever I can get in that time.
Well, if you're pushing yourself to do an hour of practice, you're going about it wrong anyway.
Yeah.
You should go 20 minutes, take a 5-10 minute break, and then do 20 minutes again, because, how many shots on a golf course are you hitting when you're focused for 25 minutes? You must be standing on the tee ripping it out of bounds over and over and over for 25 minutes. So, Tiger in his heyday was good for 20 minutes practice, then he took a 10 minute break.
Now, Jess, talk about how you know, what I hear from the rest of the panel is, the time is, you got a lot of time early in the day or late in the day. I mean, Is that somewhere yeah. down the road that you go?
Well, yes. Okay. Yes and no. So I love what Matt said about knowing who you are and what works for you. We all have a system that works best for us, whether that's playing a lot or whether that's grinding it out on the range. For me personally, my theme is about balance and consistency, whether it's golf or whether it's working out. My strategy with fitness in the off season is more strength, power, explosiveness. During the season, it's once or twice, realistically, how often can you get to the gym and get early practices or even late practices? You run out of energy, right? So 7 months you're going strong. So if you do a little consistently, that tends to work best for me. So during the season, it's more about movement. So my hip flexors are really tight, so shoulders are really tight, so and that affects my swing. Those two things seriously affect my ball striking. So those are two areas I always focus on. As far as practicing and playing is where I play best in tournaments when I've played a lot, whether that's from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. or whether that's 18 holes with the pro league. Obviously not playing much 18 hole golf during the day, during the season, but that's usually an hour and a half. So my morning practices are usually get to the putting green before the mowers at 6:30. Then I escape to the golf course, because we don't have a short game area at Innes Arden, so I escape to the green until the mowers come there, and then I can get to the range. At that point, the mowers are done with the range. And then it's time to start the day. So as far as tournaments go, you know, we all look ahead, what does the schedule look like as far as the club calendar? What events are you going to be able to play in? And I try to treat each event as one. So instead of giving any priority to one over another one, I try to give everything, kind of balance it so that I'm not overloading it. Like this year I may not play as many Mondays as others just to have a few more days off. But I try to balance it more that everything is the value of one. And the mistake I made last year with KPMG is I changed so much leading up to that, because that was going to be my, I was going to make that first cut in the LPGA. And all of a sudden I got there the week of, and it wasn't my game. It wasn't me. I had changed things in my swing that were not my swing. And under pressure, you're not going to be able to rely on something that's new or borrowed. And so the strategy this year is everything's a value of one. And to steadily prepare for everything so that, like Matt, I think Matt said, when someone calls you to the tee, you're ready, right? Or when you get into that last minute event, you get an exemption into something last minute, you're ready. You're not changing something, you're not cramming for something.
It's a great point, for sure. What I've heard so far today is I've heard the word energy come up a few times, and making sure that we control and manage our energy so we do have time to do all the things that we do have to do in a day. Let's talk a little about what we eat and how, I know, Rob, we'll start with you here.
Protein.
Why are you laughing?
Protein. We're going to finish with Rob last.
Okay, well, if I worked here with Matt, I'd be eating that line of that bar right there a little too much, but. I mean, what sort of things work for everybody when they're playing or before we start the day, or just share ideas. I mean, whatever.
So I kind of carb deplete myself before events. Uh-huh. I know it sounds weird, but 2 days before the event, I'm not eating any carbohydrates, or 3 days. It gets my body kind of in this little hunger sort of starvation mode where I go into the night before a tournament and I'll just carb load myself to death, and I've got tons of energy for the entire event. So depletion, and then put it in there, and then I can just have tons of energy. So I control my energy through food.
You always have tons of energy.
No, I control through food. You know, I try to stay away from the carbohydrates and the breads and the pastas and load up on proteins and vegetables and fruits. And then I eat a big, huge plate of carbohydrates right before tournaments, and I'm good to go.
I do the same as you do, except I'll do the depletion part. Interestingly enough, this is probably, I do two things, for anyone that's interested, not that this is, there's no science behind this, but leading up to a tournament, I eat lots of fish. I eat a ton of fish. I don't know why. I seem to play better when I eat fish at night. Take that for what it's worth. I drink a lot of water leading up to a tournament. Being dehydrated is a drag. And then I think the, and especially with juniors, so like with my kids, this is the most overlooked thing that I think is out there, is people ignore sleep. And it's funny, there's tons of studies on sleep and how it affects athletic performance. And 4 years ago, I read this Wall Street Journal article, and it talked about this direct correlation to handicap index when people get CPAP machines versus people with sleep apnea and their handicap and what it, these machines and how they treat it and what it does to their handicap without doing anything else. And the result of that study was basically that these amateurs who were 18s and 25s and just the average golfers were all cutting like 3.1 strokes off their index without doing anything differently other than just getting the proper amount of sleep. So, and what that proper amount is probably a lot more than you think. So when I started really paying attention and like making myself go to bed at 10, 9 or 10 and getting 10 hours of sleep, it helped me immensely. So that's what I do. I eat a candy bar on the 15th hole too. That seems to help too. So
always 15?
15, yeah. 15.
I ate a banana on 16.
I ate a banana on 9.
So we're a little superstitious as well, right?
Yeah, but not.
anybody out in the audience? Anything that you,
Pat? Can you talk about what you've been going through this winter?
Oh, I thought you were gonna slam me for something.
Slam?
I was expecting it too. So I didn't care about what I ate ever. You could ask anybody that I've worked with. It was never a focal point, but I actually started to
cheeseburger Pat.
Kind of go more Rob's route of less carbs, more protein, making sure I get like 6 proteins in me a day. But kind of just trying to eat better so I have more energy, which I feel like I do, especially with work and chasing around 2 kids. Small steps.
Important. What, anybody else out there, anything that you love to eat during the round that's kind of a staple?
I think Matt said it best, and I think any of us in this room, myself included, is you don't drink enough water.
Mm-hmm. People don't drink enough.
Period. I think probably most of us in this room get dehydrated in competition
and don't know it.
And don't know it. And then you make a bogey in 15 or before you get the candy bar.
How much water do you like to drink in a round? Or obviously it depends on the how hot it is, but
yeah,
is there like a number that you
like to stay open? I don't pay attention to the numbers because I don't drink enough much as I should. I think I've read and heard different things that you should drink a bottle every 2 or 3 holes. Which if you add it up, you're talking 4 or 5 bottles of water every round, and that's just on a it's easy to do in Bethany's Black in July.
But you drink a bottle of whole there.
September, and it's not, you're not even thinking about it. But I think that's something that at least I try. Mm-hmm. I want to become more aware of because I'm certain that it affects performance.
Sure. Tyler.
I know you were asking about water. So a couple years back, I would, in the middle of the night, I'd get really bad cramps in my calves. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't figure it out. So I spoke to a nutritionist. She told me that when you're not sweating, you should drink half your body weight in ounces a day. And when you are perspiring, stayed open, that you should increase that another 15%. And I started doing that, and those cramps in 4 a.m. where it jumps you right out of bed, completely stopped. And so I've tried to like follow that. And when you first start, it's a lot of water. I mean, more water than I've ever consumed. But once you get used to it, your body adapts, and it's comfortable.
I think what most people don't realize is that you have to start hydrating yourself hours before an event. You don't just get to the first tee and drink water and say, okay, I'm hydrated now. This is going to sound kind of gross, but when runners are getting ready for the marathon, they're trying to drink enough fluid so their urine is clear. That tells them that their body is hydrated.
Right.
So it's like you have to, like those hot 100 degree days when I know I'm going to be out in front of the kids all day and teaching and out in the sun all day, I wake up drinking water. Go to work, drinking water, because you got to hydrate before you start sweating. And Matt, getting back to your candy bar on the 15th tee, I've been dealing with a lot of blood sugar issues, and that's why you like that candy bar on the 15th tee, because by that time of your round, your blood sugar's down low, you eat that candy bar, blood sugar goes up, your energy goes up, and now you got the energy to finish your last 3 holes. But then you're going to crash after that.
He's not doing any playoffs because he wins by 8.
That's, right.
that's good. Yeah, for me personally, I'll throw a quick story. I mean, it's kind of funny how you know what you consume out there affects you, and you know sometimes it works, that candy bar or the whatever. When I was in college, I played a qualifying round at the University of Florida, and I was 2 over par through 8 holes. Made a birdie in the ninth, it was a par 5, then I grabbed this big cherry Coke, and I don't know why, I drank it over the course of the next few holes, and I made an eagle on 10, okay, I made par on 11, I started making some birdies. I ended up shooting 27, 9 under par on the back 9, and I guess I attributed it to the cherry Coke I drank, but I didn't crash completely, but anyway, it's, you know, most of the time you probably would, but I guess that's an anomaly, but you know, some great points about you know of how much to drink, what to drink, and what did you say? Did you say
it's water and beer, right?
Water and beer.
Yes,
water
and beer. So,
Kurt, yeah, Kurt, please.
Actually, for the two ladies up there, like, how do you manage it? Because you know we've got a restroom every 3.
No, you have to be serious.
Yeah, you have to really be careful because you know, you'd love to drink as much water, but it's a little different.
You use trees? I'm just kidding. So I read an article a couple years ago about that Julie Engster said she would drink a bottle of water before the round, bottle of water as she was warming up, and then a sip of water after every shot. So that's like 59 sips of water, right? No. So I drink a ton of water during the course because it's pretty distinct when you can realize you're all of a sudden your mind starts wandering. You can realize pretty easily when you're dehydrated, because you're not thinking as clearly. So I stay on top of it from the beginning, and I find as many bathrooms as possible.
That is the challenge, to be really honest.
Yes, having the nun out there just
right. Close. So there was a winter 2 winters ago. Where I teach in Florida, we had a restroom right next to the range. So I actually started drinking a gallon of water a day. Obviously at first very difficult, but never felt better in my life, never got one headache the entire winter. I had so much energy, I was shocked. So fast forward, you go back up north, start teaching, there's not a restroom near the range, etc. You start to decrease your water intake. And in terms of events, this is true. There are events where I know there will not be a restroom on a certain 9. So Bethpage Red, assistance event. There is no restroom on the front 9. There is a maintenance path that nobody goes on.
Hashtag Sarah was here.
I have had to ask the guys I'm playing with, and by this point in time, I at least know most of them, and I said, guys, I'm really sorry, but can you please drive your carts this way? I'm going to meet up with you in a couple minutes. One time they thought I was looking for my ball. I wasn't. I said, actually, so I'm in the fairway, and I'll meet you there in a minute. But so seriously, that is actually something that you have to think about. And sometimes you'll see us, if we have an event in Carts, like, we'll be going across fair, which, like, where are they going?
Yeah, this is all confidential, by the way.
We are learning a lot today from this panel. I can definitely. So a lot of this goes into under the whole umbrella of preparation, really. I mean, everything I'm hearing, you know, how we get ready, how we manage our energy, how we manage our food and fluid intake. You know, it kind of segues into some of the preparation of how we manage a golf course, right? For me, if I don't have a yardage book, I'm kind of lost. If I don't have that in my pocket or one of my pockets, I'm personally lost as far as my preparation. I think creating a routine is super important. And for me, that's just part of my routine. I gotta have that book. It's something I adapted about 4 years ago religiously, especially because it's difficult. Not every club that you play will have a yardage book or have that. So that's something I do in my preparation. I make sure I have some sort of book, whether it's a Google Earth image of every hole or whatnot. That's something I personally do. But anybody want to take a stab at, you know, some of the things they do pre-tournament wise? How do you prepare for a golf course? How do you make the most out of practice round?
Jump in.
Anybody.
So about 2 years ago, a good buddy of mine is an Australian, kind of like a DEA agent. He deals with a lot of bad guys. A lot of bad guys. I mean, like kingpins in the drug industry in Australia. Okay? He's a good friend of mine. Comes every year just to hang out with me and you know, take a trip to the States. So 2 years ago, he taught me about visualization. I always asked him. I said, you know, what's it like to do your job? He says, well, mate, you know, because I'm scared every day. He goes, because you know, this day could be my last. I said, well, how do you you know, navigate that? And he said, well, I don't ever envision myself getting hurt. So he goes, have you ever tried to visualize things? And I said, well, yeah, I've tried to visualize things. He goes, no, have you ever really tried to visualize things? And I sat there and I didn't know what he meant. But he said, all right, come on, we're gonna do a little exercise. And this changed my life 2 years ago. It's one of the little secrets that I use, and it takes about 10 minutes a night. It's hard to do in the beginning. I'll relate it to the Westchester Open this year. I was playing my home course, the one thing that I did, you know, prior to all my tournament wins last year, I had a good year, was I really sort of visualized myself winning these tournaments. And when I say winning them, I mean, I really, you know, I'll go to the Westchester Open. I envisioned myself walking up the 18th hole with a 3-shot lead with my arm around my son's shoulder and him looking at me saying, the people up on top, you know, with him walking up with me, and just envisioning what his face looked like to the smallest detail. And I did this a few times for some other events, and it works, which I was surprised, but it took me about a year to actually get used to it, because you sit in a dark room and your brain starts to wander so many times. So it's almost like you're taking ownership of your brain and what you think. I walked up 18 this year at the Westchester Open with a 3-shot lead with my arm around him, and I saw that happening, you know, 10 times prior to when it happened. And that was like a huge deal for me, because now I take 10 minutes, you know, every night to just kind of envision my life. You know, I've got ex-wives, we all have problems, we all have things, but if you can envision where you want your life to go and sort of envision the detail of how it's going to go, you'd be surprised on where your life will go. It works for golf, for me. I know it worked on all my tournament wins last year because I saw every one of them.
Sounds like the Long Island Medium there. That's
It was amazing for me, and it's something that I continue to do, and I'll continue to do it. And it, you know, took me a while to figure it out. But
you go through each hole in your head?
No, it's more than that. It's sort of a feeling of just the overall thing. I mean, I don't let the process, like Matt was saying, I don't let the process get in the way. I try to look at the end result, and then you know, I prepare myself every day. So it's not like I'm trying to catch up. But I prepare myself, and then if you see the process and you see it happening, it'll happen.
I'll add into something there. Certainly read some books, and also done a recommendation from someone I work with, Mario. He does Headspace every day, which is like 10 minutes of meditation. And it's not just quiet meditation, it's more guided, and it's actually a lot easier than you might expect. So I can't say that I've actually stuck to it in the light that he has, but during the busy times, in case you haven't gotten your 8 to 10 hours of sleep, which I also need as well, or else it's quite noticeable, I have found that 10 minutes of doing this headspace, it sort of has the same result as getting sleep would, because it clears your head if you're able to do it right, and it takes some time, but the different levels sort of guide you to where there's more and more quiet time, and when you first start, they're sort of talking to you the whole time. But that has actually really helped me, both if I have 10 minutes and it's a crazy day, I'm like, you know what, I'm going to go into our studio that isn't used in the summer, I'm just going to do headspace. And that's something that Brian has started to do, as I said, Mario very often, and also have used that while playing. So we had the Connecticut Open last year at Round Hill, and there was a little delay on the 18th hole. I wasn't playing particularly well to be, you know, worried about winning or anything, but it was having a good round for me, and I said, you know what, I have this birdie putt coming up, but it was going to be a while until it was my turn to hit that putt. And there's kind of some people having lunch, and I hear like the silverware going on, and there's a lot going on. But I'm like, you know, this putt would kind of mean something to me. It was going to be my sixth birdie of the round, which I don't think I've ever done before. And so I was able to use some of the techniques that I learned in Headspace while I was just seemingly standing there waiting to hit the putt. And I found that extremely valuable. So that's actually something that I've started to do before the round as well. Like, you're driving down here to Long Island, you've got the bridge, you've got your GPS yelling at you, you're almost late. If there's traffic, you will be late. Instead of warming up sometimes, I've actually sat in the car and just done Headspace. And that's been great.
Great. Now if going on to like some pre-tournament preparation, you know, that's great, something you can do in round or, you know, before the round, Rob. Also, I mean, Pat, what do you think? If, let's say you're playing an assistance event on a Monday and you can't play a practice round, you've never played the golf course. What do you do to try to get ready to play that Monday?
I will usually try to sit down, look at Google Maps. Actually, Rob's caddy, Todd, although I'm blanking on the website that he sent, the Pro Visualizer, I think is a good website to use to map out golf courses pretty easily. So I'll try to do that. I mean, I'll rely on friends that have played there and find out as much as I can about the golf course. But, I mean, if it's a place I haven't played before, I'm going on and just finding it, like going on Google Maps and checking out more stuff, tee shots, where what I can carry, what I usually can't carry, and what size of fairways looks like I want to be on.
Do you all, I mean, how about you and your tournaments, Jessica? Do you play practice rounds? Do you, what?
As often as possible, but, you know, sometimes we don't have the luxury of going and seeing the course before we tee it up there. Luckily enough, I tend to play a course the best the first time, so that helps.
Why is that, you think? Do you think you take a different strategy the first time, maybe more conservative, or?
No,
you're more aggressive. You're more aggressive.
You don't know where the bad things are.
So there's a fairway I hit.
Yeah, and a lot of times, a hole will, a lot of times, an architect will put something out there that kind of tells you where you should hit. A target is usually out there, whether it be the right edge of a bunker, or, you know, as far as visualization, you know, with driver, I try to hit the right edge of the bunker, not the bunker. With wedges, I try to hit, if I'm hitting like a little fade into it, which tends to be more of a go-to shot with my wedges. As I'm standing behind the ball, I'm picturing this ball literally hitting the left edge of this flag stick, you know? So as far as visualization, during the round, I tend to be as specific as possible. As far as practice rounds, most of it, we have the luxury of using rangefinders, so most often. If not, it is very helpful to have a yardage book. But as far as practice rounds, if you can break off early on a Sunday evening and just drive the course, like a couple years ago at Wakaba, there was no chance to play a practice round. So went up Sunday evening and just drove the course. And literally just, you know, had a little piece of paper to, or scorecard actually, to jot down little notes as far as what targets, you know, what is out there that I have to remember tomorrow that I can't see off the tee? Because the practice round to me is what is out there that you might not know is there during the round. You'd hate to hit a perfect drive and, oh, there's a creek up here, that's great.
So. John, you had a comment or question.
I stumbled upon this app, I don't know how, last year. It's called 18 Birdies.
18 Birdies.
It's a way to keep your own score on the golf course, but what I use it for is you can get aerial photographs of any golf course, and you can adjust where the tee starts and where the ball lands. So if I'm going to play a tournament where I've never seen a golf course, I spend 15 minutes and go through the golf course on that app, and I can get all my layup yardages, I can find out how far that bunker is off the tee, I can lay out the whole golf course and make a few notes, and, you know, sitting on my chair watching the evening news.
Tom, what's the name of that?
18 Birdies.
Good,
I use that as well.
Nice. Yeah, it's. Nice. I mean, it's. I just stumbled upon it, and it's been a.
Yeah, it's really good.
Yeah, it's really good.
For off the tee, figuring out where stuff is, how far to hit it, where the widest parts are.
Really right, good. And I've, you know, I found it to be, you know, fairly accurate. Only one golf course I found where they just didn't have the green in the right spot, but.
Sure. Yeah, you might want to check with the pro if they've done some renovations or whatnot. Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, but it's fairly accurate.
Paul, you had a
comment. Yeah, there's another site that I use called GolfLink, golflink.com.
GolfLink.
And it has a yearly membership, but it has all the courses, and it gives you flyovers for an elevation, and it gives you yardage maps, so you can trace out your distance and move the tee around, same as that.
Nice.
So
that's
helpful when you can't go there, you know,
right. So one of the things along those same lines, and maybe this goes a little way from preparing for the specific course you're going to play, but one of the things that I would try to do, and I would recommend that everybody do it, if you know you're going to play an assistance event or an event on a Monday, do your best a few weeks ahead of time. Try to arrange. If you have the opportunity, if your club schedule's open, try to arrange a casual round with your members the day before. I know you probably all do this, it probably makes sense, but one of the things that you should do within that round, and I do it once each 9 holes, because obviously you're out there, you're trying to converse and make sure the experience of the members is quality, but one of the things I do is on one hole per 9, I will lock into my routine. I'll kind of block the members out a little bit. Maybe it's a par 3, maybe it's whatever, it's a shorter hole, but I'll get into my routine on that particular hole and play it as much as I can in a tournament mindset. You know, looking at wind and going through, making sure my routine is solid. And I'll just do that once a 9, and then the other 8 holes on each 9, I'll make sure that, you know, I'm interacting as much as possible and, you know, being the golf pro thing. And So that's just a little trick that I do, and I think that goes back to, you know, scheduling. It all goes back to scheduling way ahead of time, right? And you know, if you can get things done way in advance, or even if it's a playing lesson, you know, even if you can, if you got an hour, maybe if you do play with, you know, maybe just even a shot, one shot, you know, this is the shot I'm going to hit on whatever hole tomorrow. You get your mind into that tournament mindset, and it's not always easy to replicate, but. Yeah, I think our minds can really do a lot in that space. So, Matt, talk about some of the tournament prep that you do.
In 2012, when I won the Club Pro in California, I didn't have time to play a practice round when I went out there. So, on the main course,
didn't play a practice round on you.
I won. Yeah. So
won by a lot.
Won by two. So.
11.
Yeah. But what I did do, what I stumbled upon, you know, and I wasn't smart enough to go on Google Earth at the time and figure out where things were. What I did was I went and I walked. There were people still on the front. I can't remember how it ever worked out, but I went and I started on 18 green and I went backwards. And I went and I sort of got a really good lay of the land. I mean, you know, designers are paid to deceive you, and the only way you remove that deception is by looking from their perspective, and that's how they're approaching these holes, to confuse you on the tee. And when you remove that, those visual cues, and you start looking at it from the other direction, you start to understand where you should miss these shots. And so I went around and I was like, man, there's a lot of space here, there's a lot of space there. And in the event, I hit drivers in a lot of places that I never would have if I walked it the other way, because it would have looked too tight.
Help stay at 400 yards
to do it, right? So right, but I'm scared. You know, I'm scared of hitting it out of place like everybody else. So But when I sort of got that perspective, I was like, oh, geez, man, there's a mile of room this way or that way. And I think the other app, which I find useful, and I've sort of been talking to this guy, Scott Fawcett, for a while, and he was up at your place, Rob. I missed that event. But, you know, I think that most people, even the average playing assistant, I think that most players are more predictable than you really think. And I think that understanding your spreads in terms of your right, left misses, how wide that area is, and understanding, you know, now if I have 67 yards of room between penalty shots I hit driver, it doesn't matter what else is up there anymore. And that's helped me a lot. And it takes the emotion out of choosing what club to hit off the tee, where do you aim into a green. So I would suggest, you know, looking into the decade system. It's something simple, pretty simple, I would say. And once you really understand, you know, everybody's got a shotgun pattern. Nobody hits it tight, and nobody hits, you know, everything inside of a 10-yard circle. Everybody's got a certain width they hit every club. And when you understand that, and you understand the percentage of misses right and left, and the standard deviations, and it sounds complex, but it's really not. Once you understand those things, you know exactly where to aim when the pin's cut four paces off the edge and you have 150 yards in. You know exactly where to aim. There's no guessing about it. And I think part of the challenge of tournament golf is all of these influences that are making you question what you're doing. And so that's why it's difficult to perform. That's why it's harder to play in tournaments than it is out when you're screwing around and nobody's there. So when you remove all of those doubt, and you remove all of that doubt from the choice that you make, it makes it easier to execute.
That's great. I mean, we talked a lot about preparation, how to get our game ready before an event or whatnot. Let's take a 5-minute break. We'll come back and talk about some how to dial in your equipment and maybe talk a little about that, talk a little about what you should do in tournament, post tournament. You know, we can expand on this data collection. I think that's very, very important. So let's take a couple minute break and we'll come right back. Thanks.